Come on, I don't think I heard it loud enough from the men. Happy Mother's Day. Perfect. Wonderful. I'm so happy to see all of your beautiful faces, moms, grandmas, nannies, whoever we may have, aunts. Such a privilege to be in the house of the Lord with you this morning and to worship with you. No other place that I'd rather be on Mother's Day. And I'm happy to be a part with you. I'm going to go to the word of the Lord real quick. Galatians 5:22 says, "But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law." Jumping down to verse 25, "If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit." I can look around at so many of you ladies this morning and truly say there's so much beautiful fruit, so much love as mothers that we give and we pour out. We're patient. We are truly faithful to our household and faithful to the Lord. And that's more than anything, that's what I want to be. I want to bear His fruit. And I want to pour into my family and pour into this church like I feel His love pour into me. Because He likes us. He likes mothers. Jesus likes mothers. I feel like He likes us maybe a little bit more. So that's just my personal opinion. But anyway, laying all of that aside, I think it would just be wonderful. We just opened up this service with prayer, worship, inviting the Lord's presence to come in here and just have His way. I know it's Mother's Day, but the Lord can still mend and move. And moms, we are all about that, healing and nurturing. And we get it from Him because that's what He's all about. He's loving, He's faithful, He's kind, He's full of mercy and goodness. And that's, I just want to lavish on Him with some worship. So can we do that right now? Thank you, Jesus, for this day, for every mother that's in this place this morning. God, we just ask for Your Spirit to rest in this house. We give You all the praise and all the glory and all of the honor. We thank You, Lord, for Your presence that we already feel, and we just want to send up some praise and worship. Because there's nobody like You in all of the earth, God. We thank You for Your goodness. We thank You for who You are, Jesus. We worship You today. We invite You here. Have Your way in this house, Jesus. We love You, Jesus. Come on, can you open up your mouth one more time and just shower Him with some praise? However you feel comfortable. Lord, we love You, Jesus. Have Your way.
Your name,
I'll pray
your name,
hallelujah.
goes before me. Defender behind me. I won't fear. Filled with anointing. My cup's overflowing. No weapon can harm me.
Mercy.
peace to the Lord this morning.
Oh, faith, your spirit lives within me.
It's ever living.
So I will walk in your
God, I'm dead.
Your spirit lives within
me. He is alive.
My victory.
My victory.
My victory.
Your spirit.
Your spirit lives within me.
Hallelujah. He is my comfort. He is my peace. And he is my joy. Clap your hands to the Lord one more time this morning. You can be seated today. Today, of course, is Mother's Day. And there's always the struggle on what to do for mom on Mother's Day. And what kind of gift do you get her? And we start seeing some things this morning, even out on social media, where people were having breakfast made and coffee brought to them, and I even heard rumor of somebody cutting roses at 1 o'clock in the morning, and so all kinds of things happening to try to take care of mom and let her know how appreciated she is. But sometimes moms speak in code. Let me help the men for a second. As husbands, sometimes our wives speak in code. Like when you say what's wrong and she says nothing. That's not true. What that really means, and I'll help you with the translation, is you did something and I need you to figure out what it is that you did without me having to explain it to you. Just nothing. Right? I mean, it goes both ways. For the ladies, let me help you. I know it's not Father's Day, but when you ask, you know, your husband what he's thinking and he says nothing, that really is the translation. We're not really thinking anything. Just kind of spaced out a little bit. But moms and wives, they speak in code sometimes. And so sometimes we need the translation. And so when you ask them, what would you like for Mother's Day, what did most of them tell you? Nothing. Right? That's not what that means. Okay? So for any of you that said, well, I didn't get anything because she said she didn't want nothing, you're in trouble. And you better figure out how to make up for it when you leave here today. So there was a little video out there, and there was some moms that kind of said what mom lingo is, and then another lady to help translate it. So I want to help you today so that you'll better understand the language that mom speaks when she tells you that she really doesn't want anything. Just your love and your hugs is all I need. Watch this video.
Hello, I'm Carrie.
And I'm Melinda. And Carrie and I decided it would be a good idea to prepare a statement for our families who are out there searching for that elusive, perfect Mother's Day gift. Now, Carrie and I differ somewhat on ideas for this gift, and she won the coin toss.
Yay!
So I will be her interpreter. Carrie?
Thank you, Melinda.
You're welcome.
To all of our loved ones, our husbands, our children, and Miss Bonita down at the corner coffee shop that makes those little chocolate chip muffins. They are so good. I could just eat. Okay, sorry. We know you work hard all day long at your jobs and at school, and so we'd like to take the opportunity to say that this Mother's Day, all we need is your love, your time, and your affection. There's no need for material gifts such as flowers or jewelry or gift cards. We feel your appreciation and your hugs and your smiles, that sparkle in your eyes, the homemade cards, and the clay handprints. All those special moments I will cherish. The first words you spoke, the first time you walked, all those nights I stayed up with you when you were sick. I love taking care of you. I wouldn't even know what to tell you to get me for Mother's Day. Because flowers wilt, jewelry loses its shine, gift cards are lost and forgotten. But your time, your affection, Miss Bonita, those little chocolate chip muffins, they stay right here. So please don't stress out this Mother's Day. Don't worry about what to get me. I have the gift of your love, and that is all that I need. It is an honor to be your mom, because I know that our time together is so short. You won't be my baby forever. Well, just yesterday, you were toddling up to me, reaching up those little chubby arms for me to pick you up. All too soon, there will be a last goodnight story, the last nighty-night hug, the last little kiss before my little bird flies away. Aww.
Happy Mother's Day.
Happy Mother's Day!
Now I'm her interpreter. She said Happy Mother's Day.
I love my kids.
She loves her kids.
I do.
She does.
Happy Mother's Day to all the mothers here. But first of all, I want Sister C, our wonderful First Lady, to come up here with me.
We want to give honor to the best mom in the house today. Sister C is what we all aspire to be, not only just as women, but I think as mothers as well. She's patient, she's graceful, she's kind, and she's loving to everyone she comes in contact with. And we just wanted to give you a small token of our appreciation. I think at some point or another, it's safe to say she's been a mother to all of us. And now to my little one, she's the best Mimi we could ever ask for. So we just wanted to give her this gift and wish you the most blessed Mother's Day. We love you. We appreciate you. Give a round of applause to the best First Lady and mom ever.
Thank you so much for honoring. I'm sure she'll say something. She's trying to keep her words limited here this morning. Thank you so much for honoring. We love her so very, very much and all that she does. I couldn't do this without her. There's no way possible. And so we honor her today. So now that we've helped you a little bit about what to get mom and the understanding and translation, you now know and understand how to take care of mom. But then we ask our children some questions about mom. And their understanding of you is revealing in some cases. And in some cases, maybe things you didn't want us to know about you. But unfortunately, that's what happens for you on Mother's Day. And so let's see what our children had to say about mom.
Sister Bethany is special to me because she brings me to church and she treats me like her own daughter.
Because she's my mom.
She's my mother. She loves me with all her heart.
She always takes care of me and cooks for me and does my laundry and stuff.
She loves me.
She is nice.
Playing games.
You're still in trouble no matter what.
I love you.
To my room.
She likes to say, I love you.
Free stuff.
My mom's favorite food is cinnamon rolls.
My mom's favorite sweet thing is gluten-free cupcakes.
A purple flower.
My mom's favorite flower that I pick her is a white daisy.
Yes. 40.
I do not know.
She is 30.
Children a hand this morning.
I'm sure it took some work getting all of that out of them in just a short little time. Well, Sister Bethany, I believe that Jesus does love mommies. And the Bible says we have to love our dads. So, just to help you there for a minute. Welcome to Mother's Day 2018. 19, oh my Lord, I need some monitor. There's no monitor, please. That's why I messed up, because I can't hear myself. I have it down. Okay, the problem is I'm almost 47. Or am I 47? Not yet. Okay, he just turned 47. And I'm beginning. I know that I have 6 months and then I'm his age. So until then, I'm free. Okay, it does say 19 because at this age of the game, I'm beginning to need readers. Not big readers, just little readers, and I'm refusing. So, yeah, that does say 2019, just to let you know. Oh, goodness. We love taking time to set aside and appreciate all of our mothers for what they do. One day a year is not enough to show enough appreciation for what you do. Each and every lady in here come from different walks of life, different backgrounds, but today is this special day to which we celebrate the life of a mother. Without you around, and I've said this before on a Mother's Day, this place would be boring, the food would be bland, the laundry would still be unfolded, there would still be monsters under the bed, we all would have crooked teeth because Dad does not make orthodontist appointments. And second and third chances would probably not be given. So today, every child, you need to thank your mama for all those things that she does for you. I'm going to read a couple of popular ways in which we view mothers. In the words of celebrities and writers and famous historical figures, some of them say, your mother has a very tough, unrelenting job. The phrase working mother is redundant. I'd like to be the real ideal mother, but I'm too busy raising my kids. A suburban's mother's role is to deliver children obstetrically once and by car forever after. Your mother never gets a break. 24/7, you sign on to be a mother. That's the only shift that they offer. I apologize. The mystery of motherhood is this. How is it that doing it all feels like nothing is ever getting done? We can all agree with that. Your mother does too much housework. Somebody said, and remember that behind every successful woman is still a basket of dirty laundry. Now and as always, the most automated appliance in the household is the mother. That was by Beverly Jones. If evolution really works, then how come mothers only have two hands? We all mothers get stressed out by our kids. Somebody said insanity is hereditary. You get it from your children. The first 40 years of motherhood are the hardest. And the best way to keep children home is to make the home atmosphere pleasant and to let all the air out of the tires so they can never leave. I don't know who said that. I want them to go. They go when they can. I'm not shooing them off. She overprotects you. She also embarrasses you. Most of all, she is proud of you. There's only one pretty child in the world, and every mother has it. Every beetle is a gazelle in the eyes of its mother. And most of all, she loves you. To the world, you might just be one person, but to one person, you might be the world. And you love her. Moms are fantastic, even when they're spelt upside down, Pastor. It says, wow. He's made that statement, but somebody else made it too. And you cannot get rid of your mother. My mom is literally a part of me. Every time I look in the mirror, I see my mother. You can't say that about many people except relatives and organ donors, somebody said. And the last one is, and nobody will mess with you when your mama is around. The only thing worse fighting a giant scorpion was fighting a giant scorpion who is trying to protect their young. I'm going to read a poem by Helen Steiner Rice. A mother's love is something that no one can explain. It's endless and unselfish and enduring, come what may. For nothing can destroy it or take that love away. It is patient and forgiving when all others are forsaking. It never fails or falters, even though when a heart is breaking. It believes beyond believing when the world around condemns. It glows with all the beauty of the rarest, brightest gems. It is far beyond defining. It defines all explanation. It is still remains a secret like the mystery of creation. A many-splendored miracle man cannot understand, and it's another wondrous evidence of God's tender, guiding hand. So I just want to take a little poll today. How many in here are coffee drinkers? We got some coffee drinkers in the house. Yeah. I know you know what it is to enjoy a great cup of coffee. There's nothing better first thing in the morning to wake up to besides your husband. Next to a good morning, Jesus, or Lord, it's morning. It just becomes a part of who you are drinking coffee. You know, I didn't always drink coffee, I don't think. I didn't always like it. It always looked fun to me as the adults would come to my parents' house and drink coffee. It always just seemed more fun that way. Sipping away with their little coffee cups in hand, thinking they were having the best of conversation. I'm not even sure when coffee drinking started for me. Probably young in our married life, we thought that was the thing you have to do. Probably more socially when we had company. As you can tell here today, I have cups. I have many cups. The object or the duty of that cup is to possess something in that cup. Most cups often contain hot liquid. However, I have seen soup. My daddy would drink cornbread and milk out of a coffee cup sometimes, or most of the time it was out of a clear glass because it just really looked disgusting to me as a kid. But he loved it. I often have come down the steps of the morning, proceed straight to the spectacular machine that produces the hot lava, Java, that and my husband has so graciously made. That's his duty at the house, is the coffee pot. He loves it. Donning my fluffy house coat and house shoes to get me that cup of coffee, and often when I have to head off to get ready quickly, I head back up the steps with coffee in hand. Why? Because I need to get ready. I head back up the steps, and I admit to you that more times than five, at least, since we lived in this house, I have tripped with this cup of coffee in my hand. Why, you ask? It's because of those house shoes that have stretched beyond compare. I'm sure everybody has one of them. And I have tripped going upward or so not. I've either tripping going either up, and I stop so not as to have spilled four or five steps below or above coffee. And I do my best, not just because it's hot not to spill it, but because I don't want any of that loose, precious liquid to leave my cup. Because in our house, we equally have the same amount of cups. And if he gets more than me, then that means I don't get my two full cups. And I need my two full cups of a morning. So today may not be your typical Mother's Day message, but I'd like to speak from my heart. I've had, if not three or four, several confirmations on this little lesson that I'm going to present to you today. So I want to talk to you today on My Cup Runneth Over. Psalms 23, I did request they sing that song this morning. I believe it to be my favorite chapter in the Bible. Psalms 23 says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Thy rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. You anointest my head with oil, and my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." Especially verse number 5. "You anoint my head with oil, and my cup runneth over." We as mothers, sometimes we get weary. We get stressed. We get maxed out. We get glued out. We get tapped out. Sometimes just plain out. And then at times like this, it's when we feel like our cup is empty. How can it be overflowing, like the scripture says, when it's empty? Every day we empty ourselves into the lives of others, into situations, into families, into children, into coworkers. We worry about our families. We worry about our jobs, our children. Some of us even worry about the small injured animal on the side of the road. Driving by a pasture a week or so ago, there was cows out there. And I catch myself, I was by myself, yelling out loud, "Babies!" I worry that they have a place to get out of the rain. I worry that they have enough green grass to eat. I worry that the farmer hasn't checked on them lately. But just as soon as that little worry comes, it goes. It then soon passes to something else. Oftentimes, visitors come to our home, and the first thing I think of is they're hungry. They haven't eaten in days. I'm the only one that's going to provide for them in this moment. So the worry for something or to provide for them in this moment has come, and it will never go away. Therefore, I have emptied and are constantly draining my cup of silly things that don't matter. When the English began manufacturing teacups, they intimidated the Chinese style of small bowls without handles. Around the mid-1700s, handles were added so that the women would not burn their fingers. Saucers, originally small plates, would hold sauce, eventually becoming part of the cup and saucer set. At the end of the Victorian era and the beginning of the Edwardian days, people often poured the tea from their cups into the saucers to cool the beverage before sipping it. It was acceptable practice then, but probably definitely pretty awkward now if any of you were to be pouring your coffee into your little cup. Most of the time, just let it sit around for about 5 minutes and it'll cool down. The dictionary definition of overflow: to be filled with something that the contents spill out over the edge of the container. To have an abundance of something, especially an emotion or characteristic, such as that it seems like someone or something can't contain it. Another definition says overflow. It's a verb. To cover with or as if with water. To flow over the brim of, to cause it to overflow its bounds, to fill a space to capacity, to spread beyond its limits. Today, you hold life. You hold the cup, the mug, the beaker, the vessel. However we want to refer to it, we choose how much quality and quantity goes in to our life's cups. We choose to let it overflow, or we choose to keep just enough in it for the time being. Others can drain and exhaust our cup, but today, it's my cup. My choosing to just feel how much and overflowing that it can be. We can choose to fill it with sorrows and hardship and anguish and happiness, regret and worry and distress. Or we can choose to fill it with love and rejoicing and gladness, fun and peace and joy and satisfaction. The scripture says it's like a spring welling up within. Mothers, we have disappointments that come to us. Tragedy strikes us, and some may say, "My cup is empty. It's so dry. What's in my cup? There's nothing in it but dry leftover liquid on the bottom. Everything has gone up and it's left." But I want you to know you still have your cup. Some of us at one time or another needs to go ahead, give up your sippy cup. You've been carrying around that sippy cup. you carry it around because you don't want to spill out. You don't want to pour out on somebody else what's inside because you're afraid you won't get any more. What you have in your possession, somebody else needs to feel it and they need to taste it. They need you, but if your cup seems low or empty, I know somebody who can give you the means to fill it again. I just say, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life. I say, my cup runs over because he's able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we can ask or think. And the power that worketh in me. You see, he doesn't simply splash a little joy and peace in our general direction and our cup, and hopefully it makes it. He stands before you and pours out all that you need until your arms are filled and your heart is about to burst. One translation in Romans 15:13, it says, I pray that God, who gives hope, will bless you with complete happiness and peace because of your faith. And may the power of the Holy Spirit live within you. The King James Version says, now the God of hope will fill you with all joy and peace and believing, that ye may abound in hope through the power of the Holy Ghost. And verse 14, and I myself also am persuaded of you, my brethren, my sisters, that ye are full of goodness, filled with all the knowledge and able also to admonish one another, to pour out to someone else. Another translation, it says, to pour out with more hope than your heart can possibly contain. You with so much hope to spare that you bathe everyone who crosses your path. You knowing that there's more hope to come from because your confidence is in his promises. It means an endless supply. The Greek word persirio means to be over and above, to abound, to seek the ordinary. This isn't a small measure of hope that he's given. It's enough to make you brim over, to spill out, to overflow your banks, such that with your whole life and outlook may be radiant with hope. You know, as small children, Sister Ashley, those pictures, some of children walk past a puddle that is overflowed into the walkway, and the temptation to play or tromp in the puddle is simply irresistible. I know many of you have probably taken your child by the hand and have walked near a puddle and they aim straight for that puddle. They don't just tiptoe through it, they pounce in it. I saw a little clip today, this morning, and it was a slide that, two slides next to each other, and kids, one by one, were going down this slide, but at the bottom of that slide was a huge mud puddle. They were having the best time in that mud puddle. I can remember, show that little short clip. I found this. In ditches full of water as a child, only got us itchy legs, dirty wet clothes, and possibly ringworm. But it did not stop us from the next time playing in the rainstorm or in something that had overflowed. The most fun was the rushing water coming from the drain pipe or clogged sewer drain or the runoff. But the joy of being in the overflow was something not to be compared to. Sometimes we think as women that the overflow or flooding causes damage, sadness, and loss. I'm here to tell you there's some disasters in this life we live. We cannot control some losses. Loss of a child, loss of a home to a fire, a car accident, a loss of a job. Just when you think life is going as planned, something rushes in to give you a blow. This morning, somebody, a lady on Pastor's Wife's page posted, and this is true life for her. It said, some cups are just too hard to drink from. So how does one say, nevertheless, thy will be done? Therefore, the emptying comes. Your cup is being emptied of its contagious contents. Your waterfall of life has seemed to dissipate. It has seemingly stopped because of the rocks and the sticks and the debris has gotten in the way of the flow. Some will say, but her cup, her water is flowing. It never ends. It's touching others' lives. And I'm over here with a little trickle of water that's ponding up and drawing mosquitoes. I know some of us can relate. But you don't understand. I've lost my child, Sister C. My child's walked out on God. I've lost my job. I can't attain the degree that I've always wanted. Life isn't fair. Every time I get up, I get kicked back down. I've had some difficult times in life. Sisters in here today, if we could all sit down and share the heartaches and the stories of our life, we would all be batting the same score. We would all be sharing the same losses in life. But I'm here to tell you, look down at what's in your hand. Look what you possess. We don't all hold the cup that, don't we all hold the cup that our Creator gave us? It might be empty for a season, but weeping may endure for the night, but joy comes in the morning, refreshing that never ends. He is the one who in the morning, it's the joy that comes in the morning. He is the one who created the streams and the brooks and the oceans and the seas. He's waiting on you to see that you still have your cup because he wants to fill it. Some of us need to realize that our waterfall seems to have dried up. Or has it even started? Look deep within your soul. Look deep within your spirit. Maybe yours is building underground. Some of the most beautiful waterfalls have been found underground. The human eye can't see it because we're not willing to look beneath the surface. Beneath the rocks, beneath the cold soil. And if and when we do, then we can only see the beauty once again. This goes with talents and abilities. Some can speak, some can teach, some can preach. All your abilities may be on the outside. Some are found deep within. Stop looking at what you cannot see in yourself or your others because we all have something deep down inside. We all hold a cup. A cup that can be filled and overflowing. He said, I will give you living water that you will never thirst again. I want it to be said of me. I've given all I can give. Life has given me blows I cannot stand up to, but no matter what, I will still be carrying this cup to my knees. I may dance in the rain with my cup next to my chest, as empty as it can be. And all I have to do is lift it to the Maker, the Creator of all, for He fills it. He gives me just what I can carry. And it overflows. The Scripture says, there is a river that maketh glad. I was praying the other night at prayer meeting, and I was asking God to give me the words to say. Help me get my thoughts together, God. Help me to bring it all together. This is not what I like to do. This is not in my forte. This is not who I am. But please just help me present this in a way. And as I looked down at my hands, I said, I haven't much to offer. But God, I've been in their shoes, and maybe I still am in some points. And as I pray, I look down at the position of my hands. And as they were in a resemblance of a cup. I was holding my hands such as that. So today, if you feel like you've lost your joy, if you lost your overflow, you've lost your cup along the way, today you have an immeasurable cup deep within you. Just place your hands together and let Him fill it. Some of us need to find our cup. Have you laid it down somewhere? Has it been broken? Maybe it's upside down in the sink of life. We find God trying to speak to us, trying to fill our cups, trying to beckon us to the level He wants to take us to. We're over here with our cup turned upside down. The same time we're asking God, why? Why am I in this situation? Why this battle? He's just wanting to fill that cup. We need more cups running over than empty cups. You cannot give to someone when your cup is empty. Look at the contents within your cup. Do we say the cup is half full or half empty? To the pessimist, the worry wart, the killjoy, the worrier, the Debbie Downer. Sorry, Sister Debbie. To me, this cup is half full. Because soon, He's going to give me full and running over. Some have been satisfied with what's in the cup since the beginning. I want to keep what's in that cup in case I don't get any more, thus becoming stagnant in prayer, slack of devotion, less committed to the kingdom, and barely loving each other. You were intended to pour out of what is in that cup on others. The contents of your cup, to get those around you drenched in the blessings of your cup so then He can give you more than you can contain. They soon will say, where is that fountain that she has been filling up? I need some. The scripture says, if it hasn't been for the Lord who was on my side, where would I be? But it's because of Him why you have your overflow in your cup. It doesn't matter what you face, what disappointments you have. If you possess a cup, then you're more than a conqueror. Through Him who loved you and gave Himself for you, enjoy your cup. Focus on the overflow and what's spilling over rather than all the things that won't matter. Again, what you possess in your cup is what somebody else needs. If you have to, drink from the saucer. If life's too hot or too hard, pour it in that saucer and drink. My failures, your failures, do not dictate the level of the contents in your cup. We might be low, but the Bible says His mercies are new every morning. I don't know about you, but I use up everything and every day because I'm so grateful for His new mercies every day. Lamentations 21:24 in the New Living, it says, this I recall to my mind, therefore I have hope. It is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed because His compassions fail not. They are new every morning, so great is Thy faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, saith my soul, therefore I will hope in Him. He fills my cup every single day. Your opinion of my cup doesn't matter because I'm the one holding my cup. Look at somebody and say, I'm holding my cup. I choose to let Him fill it daily with His grace and His mercy. Now turn to somebody else and say, where's your cup? Psalms 23, again, verse 5. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, and my cup runneth over. So today, some of your cups may have been chipped, broken, in your journey of life. Some may not even realize they have placed their cups somewhere else. Some sisters may have cups overflowing and some cups there may be empty. But we need to look deep down in what we possess. Even if we have to make a cup with our hands and let Him fill it. Know this, you possess the very thing He desires to fill each and every day with His mercies. I don't want my cup to just be filled. I want it to overflow. Just like in a stream, don't stay where the water ponds. Get to where it overflows, over the rocks, over the sticks, over the debris. It will only make you stronger. If we never open those borders, how can we overflow out? How can we flow into the mainstream of life, into the dry, cracked crevices of others' lives? How can we be the nourishment for others? You're the strongest when you overflow. Find your purpose in this overflow, what God has intended you to be. I want to drink from this saucer when it overflows. Today, as we come to a close, we're going to be doing a song today, displaying some of our precious mothers who have come through situations in life. If you received a text message from me, there are 22 of you. You can go ahead and go now. I asked some of these ladies, or they actually come to me, I ask, and they came, to share a testimony that some of you out here may not realize. You may not know what they've been through, but they will be strengthened by their testimony. You know, they all could stay in that place, in the darkness and in the position that life was given them. But through it all, God gave and is giving them the confidence, the strength, and the peace, and the perseverance to make it through. At the end of the service today, as each mother and lady take your gift today at the end of service, know that you possess the greatest of blessing is your cup. Whether or not you drink coffee, it's okay. You can have a cup. Let it overflow. Let that be a reminder that life can give you what it may, but His word cannot lie, because He said, "My cup runneth over." The song that we're going to do today, it's a recorded song. We may have to play it a couple times for everybody to get through their testimony. And we didn't practice this, so just bear with us. The song simply states, "Lord, I've come to my end. Out of the shadows, I see your hand. I believe what you said, that you're not done with me. I know you'll always make a way. I know you've always stayed the same. I believe what you said, that you're not done with me. Though my hands may fail and my heart may stray, your promises remain. So I come to you because, Lord, my cup is empty. Fill me with your spirit to overflow. I don't want to move until you move. I don't want to speak until you do. I rid myself of all of you, of all but you, because you are not done with me. You are good. You are good. You are good, and you will always be." Just like the song that we sang today. The Lord is my shepherd. He goes before me, defender behind me, and I won't fear. I'm filled with anointing, and my cup is overflowing. No weapon can harm me. I will not fear. So hallelujah, I am not alone. He is my comfort. He always holds me close, because He always guides me through the mountains and the valleys. His joy is refreshing. He restores my soul. Mercy and goodness give me assurance that one day I'll see Him face to face. Because your spirit lives within me, so I will walk in your peace. Your spirit lives within me. It's my victory. It's my victory. So today, as you take your cup, it may be empty, it may be half full, it may be half empty, but take that cup. Take that spiritual cup that you, each and every one of you, have, and hold it up so that only He can fill it. Let it spill out on somebody else. Let them feel what you feel. So today, as we begin this testimonial song, I love each and every one of you ladies. And I just want you to know that my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy will follow you all the days of your life. So take this today. I love you.
Oh, So I come to you, girl.
here knowing opportunity when God has stepped in, when everything else looked like it wouldn't work. Come on, anybody believe that God is filling your cup today? Come on, there's an overflow in the house today. God, we pray that your presence would touch, God. God, every lady in this room, Lord, let your presence, God, fill, God, that cup today, we ask in the precious name of Jesus. A powerful thought and message here today. The fact that God is filling our cups. Our cups are empty. Sometimes because of what life does to us and what life sends our way. We can't really control the things that happen in life, but we certainly can control how we respond to the things of life. We can control how we react to the things of life. We can be disappointed and down, and I love the thought of a sippy cup. We close it all off because we don't want it to overflow or spill. We want to hang on to what little bit we have, but the reality is, the only way God can make it fresh and new, at some point, you got to take that lid off. Allow some of it to overflow out. Allow some of it to pour out. But at the same time, lift it up before the Master and say, God, I need your presence today. I need your anointing today. I need your peace. I need your love. I need your kindness to fill me today. God has called each and every one of us to reach out to those who are around us. Not just those that are in the house, not just those that are here of our church family, but everybody you come in contact with each and every day. God, let my cup overflow. God, that they would feel your mercy and your joy, your peace, God, that you have shown me. Can we clap our hands to the Lord one more time here today? Amen. Thank you to each and every one of you. Mothers, we love you so much. Ladies, listen, I know that there's some of you that may not have children in the natural, but you are a mother in the spiritual to each and every child that's here. You're a mother figure, just as I've mentioned to the men. Even though you may not have children here in this church, or maybe you've never had children yourself at all, the reality is you are a mother image to every child in this church, and thank you. Thank you for upholding that image and who we are and what God has called us to be. Thank you so much for what you do. And so for every mom, every lady here today, we want you to come and take a gift, take it home with you. Every time you sit down, whether you drink coffee out of it or you put you some milk in there or you put your sweet tea in there, whatever you do, whenever you have that, just remember, whatever life throws my way, I know that God will continually fill my cup, because no matter what trial comes my way, goodness and mercy is following me. I am anointed and my cup truly runneth over. God bless you today. Thank you so very much. If you want to take pictures with family, there's a little backdrop out here on the side. If you go out front, take the picture. Just please keep in mind, if you're coming in and out the door, if somebody's taking a picture, obviously you don't want the door open, and don't, you know, photobomb them and all that kind of stuff. Well, you could, but just make sure they get a good one. God bless you. We love you today. Have a great day. Spend a great day with mom today. God bless you.